Hi, everybody.
Hi, everybody. Welcome. It's Renee. I'm Renee Shea, and I think Robin's on screen, too. Yeah. We're both little icons. It's great to see everybody today, or to see virtually. And today we're going to talk about talkbacks, talking texts, pairings that promote close reading. Many of these, the ones we're going to talk about today, are from Conversations in American Literature. And we put these together for a couple of reasons that we hope will reveal themselves to you as you go through these. But we might just start to talk a little bit about the whole notion of a talkback as something that promotes students to read closely and to go back over and read again. So, Robin, you want to talk about them a little bit? And then we'll go to the Peter Bruegel one, which is the next slide.
They're intentional. Their response is prompted by a work of art, fiction, poetry, rhetoric. I'm sure you're all familiar with ekphrastic poetry. They're not just comparison-contrast, I know that they've been used quite a bit lately in Common Core, and they serve a lot of different purposes. Sometimes they bring up an issue that's still current. Sometimes they put another spin on an issue, and we'll take a look at a couple of different examples. One of the ones that you're probably familiar with is the paired text of the Bruegel painting and the poem by Musée des Beaux-Arts by Auden. And Nicole, will you flip the slide, please? Okay, so this one we know has been in a lot of the Common Core material, and it's this wonderful painting by Bruegel of Icarus falling into the sea and nobody really noticing. And Auden played on it a little bit in his famous poem, Musée des Beaux-Arts. Go ahead, Renee.
Oh.
Sorry.
No, I was just going to say, in this one, part of what we want to do with the talkback is to discuss whether it is very intentional. And as Robin said, this one obviously is Auden writing about the painting. In many ways, his writing is an interpretation of the painting. And that's one of the first things that we have with the talkbacks, that you might have a contemporary or a later poet writing in response to an earlier poet, one that we don't have today because it's not an American work, but that we like a lot, is To His Coy Mistress, for example, by Marvell, and then a contemporary woman, Annie Finch, wrote The Coy Mistress writing back. So sometimes you also can just have fun with them, and that's where we're going to start today, is to look at one, a very serious poem, an iconic poem, and then we're going to talk about how somebody could have fun with it and what that means in terms of the talkback. So if we can go to the next slide, we're going to look at a little Wallace Stevens here.
Okay. So, what Renee didn't mention is it will also give you a great idea for an activity to do with your class, one that we highly recommend. Okay. I'm going to read this out loud, the very famous 13 Ways of Looking at a Blackbird by Wallace Stevenson, a poem from 1917. It seems so contemporary. Okay. One.
Excuse me, Nicole, could you go to the next slide, please? We need to see the poems up there. Thank you.
Yeah. One. Among 20 snowy mountains, the only moving thing was the eye of the blackbird. Two. I was of three minds, like a tree in which there are three blackbirds. Three, the blackbird whirled in the autumn winds. It was a small part of the pantomime. Four, a man and a woman are one. A man, a woman, and a blackbird are one. Five, I do not know which to prefer, the beauty of inflections or the beauty of innuendos, the blackbird whistling or just after. Six, icicles filled the long window with barbaric glass. The shadow of the blackbird crossed it to and fro. The mood traced in the shadow, an indecipherable cause. Seven, thin men of Haddam, why do you imagine golden birds? Do you not see how the blackbird walks around the feet of the women about you? Eight, I know noble accents and lucid, inescapable rhythms. But I know, too, that the blackbird is involved in what I know. Nine, when the blackbird flew out of sight, it marked the edge of one of many circles. 10. At the sight of blackbirds flying in a green light, even the bawds of euphony would cry out sharply. 11. He rode over Connecticut in a glass coach. Once a fear pierced him in that he mistook the shadow of his equipage for blackbirds. 12. The river is moving. The blackbird must be flying. 13. It was evening all afternoon. It was snowing, and it was going to snow. The blackbird sat in the cedar limbs.
Okay, well, one thing I think we perhaps should have said to start with is we're not going to spend a lot of time analyzing this one. We're going to analyze in this session. We're going to read very, very closely two pairings. One is a painting and a poem, and the other pairing will be nonfiction. And this one, we really just want to illustrate one way to use the talkback as a way to encourage students to look very carefully at a particular iconic poem or a very serious poem. And then also, as Robin said, an activity that you might be able to do in your own classes that will engage students in thinking about these poems. So the Wallace Stevens one most people are probably familiar with. It's a very interesting poem about perspective. Robin, do you have anything else to say about it before we go on and let Erin take over?
It's not an easy poem, as we know, but it's strangely one I find kids sort of take to because it's so a little bit weird. One of the ways that it's interesting to approach it is as a sort of piece of film and consider where the camera is and what the eye is looking at. It's one approach, certainly talking about it as a piece of modernist art is another one. But as Renee said, what we're going to show you here, I think, is another way to bring it to life and again, open up another possible activity. So let's bring in our guest.
Yeah, the next slide. You have the next. Okay. There's a poet in Colorado. And his name is Erin Abeta. And Erin wrote a poem called 13 Ways of Looking at a Tortilla. Now, if I were doing this in class, I would probably read it first so that the students would be I would dramatize how well he reads it and not how well I read it, because I think this is one where his voice makes a big difference. But anyway, we ask him to read this poem and to talk about why he wrote 13 Ways of Looking at a Tortilla. So we have a little interview with him here that we'd like you to listen to. It's very short, but he talks about Stevens and then he reads his poem. You'll hear me asking him some questions as part of it. Let's hit the button here.
Thank you so much for being with us. And the first thing I'm going to ask you is, do you like Wallace Stevens?
Yeah, he's one of my literary heroes. I think one of the very first poems I ever fell in love with was I Gave Order at Key West. And I will admit, I don't necessarily understand him, but I don't think he's necessarily meant to be understood in some instances. I think he's a difficult poet, but I admire the way that he uses language. I admire the way that he can evoke feeling, and just the rhythms of his poetry is mesmerizing, at least to me.
So how did you write 13 Ways of Looking at a Tortilla?
Well, it's a very long story, but I'll give you the shortest version possible. And it was an assignment for a master's class when I was getting my MFA at Colorado State. And the assignment was to model a poem. And I was trying to model many other poems, all of which I've forgotten. For whatever reason, I was reminded of an earlier poem I had written where I had included the name Ramon Fernandez. Of course, I talked about Idea of Order at Key West a little while ago. So anyway, I started looking through Wallace Stevens. I found it 13 Ways of Looking at a Blackbird. And I thought, well, I'm gonna try and make that line, but still be true to him. I want it to be an homage to him. At the same time, I want to make it completely my own. So that's where the tortilla replaced the blackbird, and that's where New Mexico replaced Connecticut, and that's where the Spanish replaced some of the more, should we call it, high language of the Stevens poem. Does that make sense?
It makes perfect sense. Would you mind reading your poem?
No, I don't mind at all. 13 ways of looking at a tortilla. 1. Among 20 different tortillas, the only thing moving was the mouth of the niño. 2. I was of three cultures, like a tortilla, for which there are three bolillos. Three. The tortilla grew on a wooden table. It was a small part of the earth. Four. A house and a tortilla are one. A man, a woman, and a tortilla are one. Five. I do not know which to prefer, the beauty of the red wall or the beauty of the green wall. The tortilla fresh or just after. Six. Tortillas fill the small kitchen with ancient shadows. The shadow of Maclovia cooking long ago. The tortilla roll from the shadow, the innate roundness. Seven. Oh, thin viejos of Chimayo, why do you imagine biscuits? Do you not see how the tortilla lives with the hands of the women about you? Eight. I know soft corn and beautiful, inescapable sopapillas, but I know too that the tortilla has taught me what I know. Nine. When the tortilla is gone, it marks the end of one of many tortillas. 10. At the sight of tortillas browning on a black comal, even the pachucos of Española would cry out, sharply. 11. He rode over New Mexico in a pearl lowrider. Once he got a flat. In that, he mistook the shadow of his spare for a tortilla. 12. The abuelitas are moving. The tortilla must be baking. 13. It was Cinco de Mayo all year. It was warm, and it was going to get warmer. The tortilla sat on the frijolito plate.
You can see what Aaron has done there is really to, as he says, it's both an homage to Wallace Stevens, and I think that's where we begin. And it is also a playful poem. As he said, he's done his own. He wanted to put enough of himself in there as well as pay tribute to Wallace Stevens. And I think that's the first thing that we talk about with talkbacks.
Nicole, could you flip to the next slide, please? Great. So here's the poem if you'd like to take a look at it. It was wonderful hearing Aaron read it out loud, of course, and especially the untranslated Spanish, which is really quite terrific. And for me, every time I look at his poem, I feel like I understand the Wallace Stevens poem a little bit better. He kind of guides me in some ways, and maybe it's just because it's a little lighter and it's a little bit more humorous, but I find that the images are very similar, and so are the themes.
That's exactly what we hope. I mean, what Robin said is exactly what we want to happen, which is that that you understand the Wallace Stevens poem a little bit better because you've looked at this one. Now, imagine had you been the one who wrote this poem, how much you would have had to understand Wallace Stevens in order for that to work. So that's really the first way that we want to think about the talkbacks. And also, Aaron reminds us that we all know that a really important way that we have talkbacks is that we reverse that subject-object position. Perhaps the most famous one, or at least in our that most of us have taught, would be Jane Eyre and White Sargasso Sea. Because there, you have Jane Eyre with Bertha in the attic, and then when you end up in Wide Sargasso Sea, you flip it and you get the perspective of Bertha, so that you get a different voice, and that really is where that concept of the talk back comes in. Again, sometimes it is an homage, it's a tribute, but at the same time, it can also be a bit of a protest, and that really segues into our next one.
But before we go, Nicole, could you just flip to the next slide? We have a couple of questions here that, you know, you might want to bring to your class to address, not the comparison-contrast, because we don't think that that's what the purpose of these are, but just ways to open the discussion, maybe to provide writing assignments. And so these were just a set of questions that we suggest. So One would be, besides the subject, what's the difference, biggest difference between the two poems? And I think answers will vary here. Abeda's purpose, homage or satire, or a combination? And we think you could make an argument for any one of those, homage, satire, or a combination. The effect of the two locations, Connecticut and Chimayo. And then number four, which is the activity we suggest, to have your students write their own version of a poem that looks at a familiar object 13 different ways. I know years ago there was one in the New Yorker, 13 ways of looking at a blackberry. That's a little dated now, but it's quite charming if you can find it. But I'm sure your students might have fun with 13 ways of looking at an iPhone, for example. But now we're going to move to a set of texts. One a visual and one a poem that, you know, really have a little bit more depth of analysis available for us now. Nicole, could you put that's it. Okay, exactly. So
before we go to the painting, what we're going to do is look at a talkback that is very deliberate. I mean, this is a Winslow Homer painting, The Veteran in a New Field, and we'll talk about that. And then we're going to look at a poem by Natasha Trethewey, a contemporary African-American poet who was the poet laureate, and she entitles her poem, Again, The Field. So this is, again, a very deliberate talkback. It's not one that we found and said, oh, these do work well together. This was Natasha Trethewey talking back to Homer. So we're just going to start with the painting. And very often you do, and this is, again, like the Bruegel and the Auden one, very nicely paired with the painting, which we know often engages students in ways that a more difficult poem might not. So Robin's going to talk about Winslow Homer, and then from there I'll do a little talking about Trethewey. Robin?
Okay. I find working with visual text very satisfying. I find that students take risks in their analysis that they're a little afraid to do with text, but that there really is a carryover. So I'm going to do a little close reading of this painting, which is 1865. Winslow Homer, it's oil on canvas. It's not very big. It's little over 24 inches by 38 inches. It hangs in the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York. And it's wonderful to go see in person. But it also, I think, shows up really nicely in reproduction. So the Metropolitan Museum of Art's website says this about the painting. Painted through the summer and fall of 1865, not long after the nation came to grips with Robert E. Lee's surrender and mourned President Lincoln's assassination, both of which occurred during the second week of April, Homer's canvas shows an emblematic farmer who's a Union veteran, as is signified by his discarded jacket and canteen at the lower right. The painting seems to blend several related narratives. Most soldiers had been farmers before the war. This man, who's returned to his field, holds an old-fashioned scythe that evokes the Grim Reaper, recalls the war's harvest of death, and expresses grief upon Lincoln's murder. The redemptive feature is the bountiful wheat, a northern crop which could connote the Union's victory. With its dual references to death and life, Homer's iconic composition offers a powerful meditation on America's sacrifices and its potential for recovery. Now, you know, that's the Metropolitan Museum of Art doing our homework for us, and we hope that when you show this to your students, you let them do a little bit of close reading without that, because I think there are more things to look at in the painting. You'll notice that the character is centered on the canvas, and the sky, the uncut wheat, and the cut wheat make up a third of the canvas each. The horizon is very high. It's almost hard to look over the wheat to see it. But those horizontal lines really do create a feeling of peace. The veteran's back is to us, and while his body swings left, his upper body, I should say, swings left, his head faces forward. As we mentioned above, his scythe is a little unusual. We'll come back to that. But it's swung out. It's about to swing right for another cut. So there's a feeling of him being caught in a moment. The veteran is sturdy on his feet, on his two feet, and in the right foreground you can see his jacket and his canteen that he's dropped on the ground. The colors are vivid. The blue and gold, I was looking at this and all I could think of was amber waves of grain and beautiful for spacious skies, although America the Beautiful was written 50 years later, almost 50 years later. The lines of the grain in the foreground direct your eye to the veteran and also push our eyes up to the sky through that narrow figure in the center of the frame. And our eyes are also forced left and right to take in the openness of the field and the harvest. In this painting, as the Met mentions, the veteran farmer uses a single-bladed scythe, and this was already out of date in 1865. The first scythe that he painted, that Homer painted, is faintly visible in the picture, but of course this scythe certainly references the Grim Reaper, who is always pictured with a single-bladed scythe like this one. As we know, some of the bloodiest battles of the Civil War were fought in fields of grain, and if you have CIA lit, you can see the photographs such as the Confederate dead before the Dunker Church and A Harvest of Death on pages 685 and 86. Both very vivid photographs of dead bodies on fields of wheat. So this painting tells a lot of different stories, I think, and it asks a lot of questions, too. You know, one, based on the title, is that the farmer's an archetype, and as the Met says, an emblem, representative of all veterans. You know, we can read him as a northerner because that's what his coat is, but, you know, he's out there with no jacket on, and he does seem very, very universal. We don't see his face, just his body. It's somewhat stooped, but it's hard at work and sturdy. Another story is that the farmer has come upon a field needing harvesting, thrown down his jacket, and gotten to work. I don't know. There's something so spontaneous about this. Is it the North? Is it the South? Does it really matter? Apparently, the year after the Civil War, the harvest was as rich as it had ever been. You know, it asks a question about what the veterans will do when they return to war. As we know, almost all of the many of the soldiers on the North and the South were farmers. What fields will they sow? What does it mean that the farmer can barely see over the wheat? It's kind of interesting that it's so high and the sky is so almost out of the picture. It's a story of redemption, certainly, the fields growing, the bloodied fields redeeming themselves in wheat and grain, even on the bloodiest of battlefields. And finally, it's always interesting to see what's not in the frame. We don't know where the veteran came from, where the field is located. We can't see beyond the high wheat. And now we'll take a look at what Natasha Trethewey has to say about what she thinks might be just outside the frame. Renee?
Thank you, Robin. And, you know, that really raises another question before we get to the poem itself, and that is the legitimacy of looking outside the frame. And that, I think, is an important one for kids to think about. You know, as I said with White Sargasso Sea, you look at someone writing many years later, is it fair to ask questions and to expect certain kinds of things from people at one period of time when you look back? I mean, that retrospective revisionism. But Trethewey, again, does it. She says, again, the fields after Winslow Homer. I'm sorry.
Can you flip to the poem, please? The next slide.
Yes. All right. And again, a little bit about Trethewey herself, she's also the author, and this comes from the book which won the Pulitzer Prize, called Native Guard. And the elegy for the Native Guard is a central poem in that one. And if you're interested in teaching her, there's some very nice pieces online where she actually goes to the fort where the Native Guard was. And the Native Guard were one of the first black regiments to fight for the Union during the Civil War. And Natasha Trethewey in Elegy for the Native Guard is asking, why is there not a monument for them? Why has their participation, their sacrifice, not been marked? So you might want to look at that poem as well, and as she again asks which stories to get told, and as she puts it upon herself, perhaps, to tell some of those stories, or to try. So let's just start by looking at this poem carefully. Again, the fields after Winslow Homer, the title. And then there's this epigraph. The dead they lay long the lines like sheaves of wheat. I could have walked on the bodies almost from one end to the other. And that epigraph, again, is quoting a Civil War soldier's letter to his father, and very moving, I think, in the absence of grammatical correctness, perhaps, and correct spelling. But it does raise a different image of the sheaves of wheat than the image we've just seen so beautifully rendered in Homer, and that is that the dead lay along the lines like sheaves of wheat. And as Robin also pointed out, we know that many of the battles of the Civil War were fought on wheat fields. I'm going to read the poem first, and then I'll go through it more carefully, thinking about Homer as we do it. No more muskets. The bone drag weariness of marching, the trampled grass soaked earth red as the wine of sacrament. Now the veteran turns toward a new field, bright as domes of the Republic. Here he has shrugged off the past, his jacket and canteen flung down in the corner. At the center of the painting, he anchors the Trinity, joining earth and sky. The wheat falls beneath his scythe, a language of bounty. The swathes like scripture on the field's open page. Boundless, the wheat stretches beyond the frame, as if toward a distant field. The white canvas where sky and cotton meet, where another veteran toils, his hands, the color of dark soil. I think as I read it, one of the geniuses of that poem, a genius strategy, is that it seems as though another veteran, might have been there all along, almost like a shadow figure. And at the end, when she mentions him, it seems as though, oh, he's been there. We didn't notice him. So there's something about that, I think, that's quite wonderful. I would just say to start here, you know, many of you are preparing students for the AP exam, and, you know, the title matters here. The title and the epigraph, just asking students what that does is a good place to begin. Why would she do that? And I think the why question becomes important as you ask later on, what's she doing here? You know, is she being respectful? Is she paying tribute? Is she taking issue? And what is the tone of her taking issue if she does? And I like this notion, too, of the page and the frame. So she acknowledges two artists here, one on a canvas, the other on a page. The stories that we tell on the canvas, on the page. She's bringing all of that together here in ways I think are quite intriguing. I'm just going to look very carefully at a few things here. The opening of it, I think the cadence of the opening few lines here captures the incredible weariness, the exhaustion, the sacrifice, no more muskets. All the consonants, the bone drag, weariness of marching, the trampled grass, soaked earth red as the wine. And you have so many words there beginning with consonants that just mark it. It is just a very solemn movement. And I think bone drag, weariness with the enjambment there is it just, again, captures the exhaustion and captures the long time people have been marching. And as Robin said, the first thing we notice in the painting is the lower right corner. He has dropped his musket and his jacket, and he has gotten to work in a different way. But again, the language here of sacrament, earth red as the wine of sacrament, quite a lot of religious imagery. And then as Robin was looking at the painting, we know we can go well over into the Bible and look at biblical references to the wheat and to the harvest and look at the meanings there. And there are a number of actual passages the students can uncover or that you might be able to bring to them. But then she shifts. Now the veteran turns toward a new field, bright as domes of the Republic, with a very hopeful image that follows the previous one. He turns toward a new field, bright as domes of the Republic. The domes of the Republic, such an optimistic image here, such a hopeful way of looking at things, and reminding us of what endured despite the conflict, despite the divisiveness. And then we get now, and then another shift here. He has shrugged off the past, his jacket and canteen flung down in the corner. Now, this is an interesting line, and I find that there's a lot of discussion of this notion of shrugged off the past, because, you know, that word's difficult. Shrug suggests a kind of nonchalance. If she had said he has escaped the past, of course, that would have been a pretty overt criticism. But he shrugged off the past. Has he turned away out of indifference? Has he turned away out of an effort to forget? Or has he just moved slowly, shrugging off the past the way he shrugged off his jacket, perhaps? Again, flung down is a stronger word than shrugged, and I'm making quite a lot of that word choice here, because that, I think, the choice of words here will influence how students see the intent of Trethewey in this poem. At the center of the painting, he anchors the Trinity, joining earth and sky. And again, here, the more you look at this and look at it with the painting, and right here, I might say, there's so much at the beginning of the poem here. She's almost literally translating from the canvas to language, going from the language of the art of the visual artist to the language of the poet. But here she reminds us he's at the center of painting, and he is the Trinity. There is, as Robin said, he's in the middle here. We have this beautiful wheat field. We have the sky. And then we have this man. Okay. He is the center of the painting. As we look at what comes later, we start to realize she's questioning why he's always at the center of things, perhaps. Why is he the one who anchors the Trinity, joining earth and sky, where the other veteran is off to the side? And then the wheat falls beneath his scythe, a language of bounty, the swaths like scripture on the field's open page. Again, still a meditative tone here, the language of bounty, the domes of the republic, scripture, sacrifice, that language that is biblical, that harkens back to a religious sense. And again, after the Homer knew, of course, that his audience would know the Bible well, and many turned to faith after the war as a sense of healing, as we know even from Lincoln's speeches. But here she continues with it, the swaths like scripture. She doesn't question him. But then here, boundless, the wheat stretches beyond the frame as if toward a distant field. And this is where she is stretching us, and she starts to take our attention to what is not there. Excuse me, toward a distant field, the white canvas where sky and cotton meet. I'm right aware, the white canvas. Well, it's not a white canvas. I mean, go ahead, Robin.
No, and it's not cotton. It's kind of funny that she uses that word. Although, I don't know, canvas is made out of cotton, but she's getting that cotton in there. I also couldn't help but noticing, I hadn't noticed it before, that boundless, the wheat stretches beyond. It made me think of Ozymandias and maybe a kind of backhanded comment that she's making about the sort of vanity of putting this particular veteran front and center, as Renee mentioned. Anyway, go ahead, Renee. Sorry to interrupt.
Yeah. No, not at all. Thank you. But here, the emphasis on the white canvas, there is no white canvas there, but we're reminded right away of race, and you know, immediately the stark white where sky and cotton meet. And again, yes, it is, there's no cotton in that frame, but we've gone toward a distant field, so the sky and the cotton meet in another field, again, the field, where another veteran toils, his hands the color of dark soil. You know, again, sky and cotton, is that hopeful? Another veteran toils, his hands the color of dark soil. Is it hopeful? She's bringing in a reality here. The sky is hopeful. The cotton is the reality. You know, the cotton, King Cotton and all of that. But now she has brought in a different story, a different narrative. Interestingly, she tells the story. The veteran is not the speaker here. She certainly could have had the veteran be the speaker. We could talk about what that would have done. But here she introduces him. He's not speaking. He hasn't been allowed to speak, perhaps. And she's speaking for him and reminding us his hands the color of dark soil. And, of course, the dark soil, the actual soil itself is there, but we're also thinking of earth red as the wine of sacrament and the color of the darkness of the blood as well. Now, the question is, what happens with this? What do you make of this? Is hers an homage? Is hers a retelling? It obviously is a retelling. What story is she telling? The writer is rewriting history. The poet is rewriting history here, correcting history. And then the question becomes, what is her attitude toward Winslow Homer? I think there's a slide with a few questions on here.
You would flip to the next one, Nicole.
And we talk here, the poem both describes and interprets Homer's paintings. What are the literal descriptions, which are interpretive? And that just, again, will immerse students in the language, which is always helpful. Go ahead, Robin.
Go ahead, Renee.
I was going to say, I'd like to ask Robin to start with her response to question two, and then I'll jump in too, because this is certainly where we would have our students jumping in. How would you describe Trothway's attitude toward Homer's painting? What do you think, Robin? How do you respond to this?
Well, I consider it to be appreciative, and I think I have that reaction because I think she does a beautiful close reading of the poem. Of the painting. It's something I like to do, and so it's fun to see somebody else do it. And I think in her appreciation, she does make some political comments, if you will. But she does appreciate the work of art. She doesn't say it should be different. She does, I guess, say that there could be more. But she does certainly appreciate the work of art, and so I consider. But I, again, your students might take a different tone, and Renee, you see it a little differently, I think.
Well, I don't necessarily see it differently because I do see that she appreciates it. I think she's critical less of Homer than of the way we've told our history. And so Homer becomes the tablet, if you will, sort of on which she's writing her commentary. And she does say, well, it's lovely as it is, I almost want to use the word noble. I mean, she does appreciate this as a work of art and as an extraordinary, I guess, capturing of a moment in our history, and that sense of turning away from the war and getting to work, letting those domes of the Republic, which are going to endure and have endured beyond the war, moving on. There's no question I think she appreciates that. And I agree with Robin that she's reading the painting, and that's lovely. But I do think she's critical in that she's saying it's not enough, and it's one more case where the whole story doesn't get told. But again, is she disrespectful? No. I would make a very strong, draw a strong line between being critical and being disrespectful. I think she's quite respectful here. And again, as Robin said, the poem is one that students will respond to in very different ways. I mean, this always brings to mind, Robin knows I talk about this a lot, but I love T.S. Eliot's The Presence of the Past. And the pastness and this notion that once we look at an older piece with a contemporary eye, we forever change that older piece. Not necessarily to devalue it, but to see it in another way. And in many ways, I think what Trethewey has done is called our attention to a painting that is very much a part of our history and culture and pay tribute to it, but then also say, now let's look a little further.
I like the her language. I mean, I think it would be an interesting thing to point the kids to is the sort of, at the same time that she's critical, she's also exalting. She exalts the subject of the painting, and she exalts the painting itself, and then says, yes, but also. And I think those are skills that our students would do well to emulate, but also to practice talking about. I think it's a terrific pairing, really great.
Well, and the one thing I think is an important, or could be an interesting way to look at it too, is, and we will not go into that too much here, but I think looking at both of them as elegies is nice. Let's look up the meaning of an elegy. What is it? It's a lamentation. tribute to, lamentation, or serious reflection on the dead. And that's what this really is. This is a reflective poem. It's and that's why I like the fact that it's in her voice. Well, or she creates a speaker that very much seems her voice, but it's not in the voice of the other veteran, who would probably have to speak more confrontationally, especially that whole notion of the center, you know, that this veteran is the center of the universe. Well, he's not the center of the universe. The other veteran is pointing out there's someone else here, too. But I think in this case, she is reflecting, and that's what she's asking us to do. So it works. I think you probably can tell by now, Robin and I really like both Winslow Homer and Natasha Trethewey. But we hope you'll try this with your students and see how they respond. And that whole notion then of asking them perhaps, well, we ask, there's a question here, say, how might Homer have responded to Trethewey's poem? That's one way to look at it. But also go a little further. Ask them to think of take a painting that are a monument or a memorial of a work of visual art that commemorates a particular moment in time or history or a particular historical event, or that ask people to remember the war or a war, and then write your own response to it in a more contemporary way, asking, perhaps considering what's not there, and going outside the frame.
That Homer did work during the Civil War. I mean, he was asked to go and record and paint and report back. So he was not a distant observer. He was there. He saw all kinds of things. He has a lot of Civil War paintings. Some people consider them over-romanticized, but I think there was a wonderful exhibit of Winslow of Civil War art at the Met a couple of years ago, and they're not very sentimental at all. They tell stories, certainly, but they're not sentimental. So it would be interesting to do a little research on him and see what his views were, and then maybe have him respond to Trethewey, defend himself even.
Absolutely. All right, well, now we're going to turn to another pairing, and this is a pairing of two prose pieces. But one is fiction and one is nonfiction. Nicole, can we go to the next one, I think? We're going to look at two pieces here. One is From the Jungle by Upton Sinclair. And so we have a novel. And then the other is From Fast Food Nation by Eric Schlosser. You're probably very familiar with the latter, and you may at some point have read parts of or have read the former. Robin was saying today that she remembers reading Upton Sinclair when she was 14. And I don't think it's taught in its entirety very much these days, but it's in some ways come back onto the scene because of Eric Schlosser and because of his the work that he's done with the meatpacking industry. Mm-hmm. I want to start too by saying that pairing fiction and nonfiction, I think it's really important in the AP language class, because a lot of times students come to nonfiction and many of us as teachers came to nonfiction saying, okay, well, this is what Louise Rosenblatt called efferent writing. This is just informational writing. That's what we've got. And the aesthetic reading is from fiction and poetry. The more you read nonfiction, of course, in these days, there's been such magnificent nonfiction written. But the more you read, you start to recognize that they're strategies. I mean, when we talk about rhetorical strategies, the rhetorical strategies are very, very similar. And I think this pairing demonstrates this. The pairing also demonstrates something else that's less literary and less rhetorical and less teacherly, and that is more political, and that is that there is a persistent problem. And this problem, which we're looking at, which Upton Sinclair wrote about in the early part of the 1900s, still exists toward the very end of the century. And the pairing makes that point. Are these direct talkbacks? Not exactly, but sort of. And that is that, obviously, Upton Sinclair didn't know Schlosser, but Schlosser writes about Upton Sinclair and writes about the fact that he would be horrified to see that the problems that he wrote about still exist today in somewhat the same form, in fact. So it is a legitimate talkback in that way. But also I think the main point here is that they both are muckrakers. And we know that the term muckraker was popularized by Teddy Roosevelt. He used it in the 1906 speech actually to refer to journalists who were focusing mainly on the negative. And the term itself came from Pilgrim's Progress. But that notion of being a muckraker early in the century, later in the century, and of course Schlosser, we know, was also involved in the documentary Food, Inc., so he had another means or media available to him. I think that's really where I would start with this, two muckraking pieces. And then I would look a little bit at Sinclair and then go to Schlosser. What we're going to do here is to look only at a part of these two sections that are in CIA Lit. If you have the book, you'll see that they're longer excerpts. But just because we're going to be reading them here and talking about them, we just chose a few paragraphs from each one. Robin, you want to see what else you have to say and then get started on Sinclair?
Sure. What's interesting, too, of course, about the jungle was that, you know, we remember it as being so much about the meatpacking industry. But it was really about the experiences of this, you know, immigrant family, Jurgis Rudkus. But the intent of the novel, I mean, it was certainly polemical, was to expose the harsh lives of immigrants, especially in a capitalist society. You probably remember that the public responded very viscerally to the descriptions of the industry and reform. There was reform as a result. In the passage of the Pure Food and Drug Act by President Roosevelt in 1906. Apparently, Upton Sinclair was not happy about that because it was the reforms were going to come through taxpayer money, and I guess he was really against the owners of the business. But anyway, this passage here is from Chapter 9, and it's interesting to read it, and there are many, many different ways to look at it. But when I was looking at it recently, I was thinking about his audience. His audience and his subject are quite different in a way, and I guess that goes along with his purpose. So I'm going to read this out loud. Jurgis heard of these things little by little in the gossip of those who were obliged to perpetrate them. It seemed as if every time you met a person from a new department, you heard of new swindles and new crimes. There was, for instance, a Lithuanian who was a cattle butcher for the plant where Maria worked, which killed meat for canning only, and to hear this man describe the animals which came to his place would have been worthwhile for a Dante or a Zola. You see what I mean about audience. It seemed that they must have agencies all over the country to hunt out old and crippled and diseased cattle to be canned. There were cattle which had been fed on whiskey malt, the refuse of the breweries, and which had become what the men called steerly, which means covered with boils. It was a nasty job killing these. For when you plunged your knife into them, they would burst and splash foul-smelling stuff into your face. And when a man's sleeves were smeared with blood and his hands steeped in it, how was he ever to wipe his face or to clear his eyes so that he could see? It was such stuff such as this that made the, quote, embalmed beef that had killed several times as many United States soldiers as all the bullets of the Spaniards. Only the army beef, besides, was not fresh canned. It was old stuff that had been lying for years in the cellars. Then one Sunday evening, Jurgis sat puffing his pipe by the kitchen stove and talking with an old fellow whom Jonas had introduced and who worked in the canning rooms at Durham's. And so Jurgis learned a few things about the great and only Durham canned goods, which had become a national institution. They were regular alchemists at Durham's. They advertised a mushroom catsup, and the men who made it did not know what a mushroom looked like. They advertised potted chicken, and it was like the boarding house soup of the comic papers through which a chicken had walked with rubbers on. Perhaps they had a secret process for making chickens chemically. Who knows, said Jurgis's friend. The things that went into the mixture were tripe and the fat of pork and beef suet and the hearts of beef and finally the waste ends of veal when they had any. They put these up in several grades and sold them at several prices, but the contents of the cans all came out of the same hopper. And then there was potted game and potted grouse and deviled ham, deviled, as the men called it. Deviled ham was made out of the waste ends of smoked beef that were too small to be sliced by the machines, and also tripe dyed with chemicals so that it would not show white, and trimmings of hams and corned beef and potatoes, skins and all, and finally the hard cartilaginous gullets of beef after the tongues had been cut out. All this ingenious mixture was ground up and flavored with spices to make it taste like something. Anybody who could invent a new imitation had been sure of a fortune from Old Durham, said Jurgis' informant. But it was hard to think of anything new in a place where so many sharp wits had been at work for so long, where men welcomed tuberculosis in the cattle they were feeding because it made them fatten more quickly, and where they bought up all the old rancid butter left over in the grocery stores of a continent and oxidized it by a forced air process to take away the odor, returned it with skim milk, and sold it in bricks in the cities. Up to a year ago, it had been the custom to kill horses in the yards, ostensibly for fertilizer. But after long agitation, the newspapers had been able to make the public realize that the horses were being canned. Now it was against the law to kill horses in Packingtown, and law was really complied with for the present at any rate. Any day, however, one might see sharp-horned and shaggy-haired creatures running with the sheep. And yet what a job you would have to get the public to believe that a good part of what it buys for lamb and mutton is really goat's flesh. There was another interesting set of statistics that a person might have gathered in Packingtown. Those are the various afflictions of the workers. When Jurgis had first inspected the packing plants with Svedvilas, he had marveled while listening to the tale of all the things that were made out of the carcasses of animals and of all the lesser industries that were maintained there. Now he found that each one of these lesser industries was a separate little inferno, in its way as horrible as the killing beds, the source and fountain of them all. The workers in each of them had their own peculiar diseases, and the wandering visitor might be skeptical about all the swindles. But he could not be skeptical about these, for the worker bore the evidence of them about on his person. Generally, he had only to hold out his hand. So pretty grim. Again, the language is sophisticated. He's writing to an educated audience, certainly, with Dante and Zola. He's not writing for the subjects of the workers, certainly. And he certainly doesn't stint on details. So, Renee, maybe you want to talk a little bit about Eric Schlosser now, and then we can talk a little bit about how to work with the two texts together.
One thing I would just like to follow up, the Dante and the Inferno part, those references are direct here. And when we look at Schlosser, it seems almost a sense that he might have studied Sinclair. Before we go to Schlosser, keep in mind, this one, Robin's absolutely right. The audience for this is very different than the subject. The intent also was more to expose the hardship of the immigrant populations working in these plants. Now, Schlosser does that as well, but I think with the fictional, with the novelist here, is working from the point of view of Jurgis. It's a third-person narrative, obviously, but Jurgis is telling, we're kind of in his head. Jurgis heard of these things little by little, and then we get all of this information. Again, so many details, almost as though there's a kind of journalistic detail here. But let me say, too, that as Robin was reading this, it's pretty vivid. It's pretty graphic, but wait till you get to Schlosser, and that's where you see the difference between the novelist and the kind of firm but steadier hand of the novelist versus the journalist, who really has a purpose here to rile people up and, in fact, to horrify them. Before we read this Schlosser piece, I almost feel like I should be on CNN and say something like, the following images are graphic and maybe disturbing because they really, really are. But let's go to the Schlosser piece here, and I'm going to read from the beginning of it. So, Nicole, if you can go to the next slide, I think that's this is from Chapter 8 of Fast Food Nation. Okay, I'm going to start to read a little bit here from Fast Food Nation, and I'm actually going to talk about it as I read it. One night I visit a slaughterhouse somewhere in the High Plains. The slaughterhouse is one of the nation's largest. About 5,000 head of cattle enter every day, single file, and leave in a different form. someone who has access to the plant, who is upset by its working conditions, offers to give me a tour. The slaughterhouse is an immense building. The slaughterhouse is one of the nation's largest. About 5,000 head of cattle enter it every day, single file. Nicole, I'm sorry. I'm reading from two different texts. I'm going to start over.
Okay. Whenever you need to.
One night I visit a slaughterhouse somewhere in the high plains. The slaughterhouse is one of the nation's largest. About 5,000 head of cattle enter it every day, single file, and leave in a different form. Someone who has access to the plant is upset by its working conditions, offers to give me a tour. The slaughterhouse is an immense building, gray and square, about three stories high, with no windows on the front and no architectural clues to what's happening inside. My friend gives me a chain mail apron and gloves, suggesting I try them on. Workers on the line wear about 8 pounds of chain mail beneath their white coats, shiny steel armor that covers their hands, wrists, stomach, and back. The chain mail is designed to protect workers from cutting themselves and from being cut by other workers, but knives somehow manage to get past it. My host hands me some Wellingtons, the kind of knee-high rubber boots the English gentlemen wear in the countryside. Tuck your pants into the boots, he says. We'll be walking through some blood. Now, right away here, we get, I visit a slaughterhouse, and how do I get access? Someone who has access has offered. Then he refers, my friend gives me a chainmail apron. Right away, we have the journalist here who's telling us, this is first person. This is, I was there. I saw this. If you want to talk in terms of rhetorical analysis, we've got ethos aplenty here. I visit this one night, first of all. Yeah, you do have a lot of plot here. I mean, I love the fact that you have almost mounting conflict as in a novel here, because it's nighttime. I go to the slaughterhouse. Here's what it looks like. And then we also, I'm putting on chain mail apron and gloves, shiny steel armor. So right away we're doing battle here. I mean, this could not be more dramatic. And so Schlosser is writing an eyewitness account. He's giving us information about, he's giving us setting, right, taking the novelist's tool here of creating setting, and also the novelist's tool of working with plot. Okay, he's given us some minor characters already. Actually, they're going to become major characters, but the workers on the line wear 8 pounds of chain mail. So we get shiny steel armor that covers their hands, wrists, stomach, and back, and just like ancient warriors, the chain mail can't protect everything. So sometimes they get hurt. And then there's a little irony in here, almost, I wouldn't say humor, but definitely irony here, when he says he's offered some Wellingtons, the kind of knee-high rubber boots that we see Queen Elizabeth wearing when she's on her one of her country estates. This is not what you would expect to see in the slaughterhouse. And, in fact, you're tucking your pants into the boots because you're going to be walking through blood, not exactly what we would expect in the setting where we find the Wellington boots on Downton Abbey. Then he says, I put on a hard hat and climb a stairway. The sounds get louder, factory sounds, the noise of power tools and machinery, bursts of compressed air. We start at the end of the line, the fabricating room. Workers call it fab. When we step inside, fab seems familiar, and catwalks, pipes along the walls, a vast room, a maze of conveyor belts. This could be the Lamb Weston plant in Idaho, except hunks of red meat ride the belts instead of French fries. Some machines assemble cardboard boxes, others vacuum seal subprimals of beef in clear plastic. The workers look extremely busy, but there's something unsettling about this part of the plant. You see meat like this all the time in the back of your local supermarket. Again, the surrealism of it here as he's putting it together. Each of our senses is not just evoked, but it's almost the senses are assaulted. Notice we're getting a lot of visuals here, obviously. One of the things we also find here is that there's no sound from the workers. I mean, there's sound in the fab, as it were, and that is in and of itself a bit of surrealism here, and it is fabulous in the original meaning of the word, but the workers are quiet, and then we get this silence of the workers in terms of their participation in anything that's going on, but then you also, they're existing in this setting where there's a great deal of noise and jarring noise, dissonance, where you look. The fab room, and also in the next one here, the fab room is cooled to about 40 degrees. Notice the plot heating up here. And as you head up the line, the feel of the place starts to change, intensifying conflict here, very much like a story. The pieces of meat get bigger. Workers, about half of them women, almost all of them young and Latino, slice meat with long, slender knives. They stand at a table that's chest high, grab meat off a conveyor belt, trim away fat, throw meat back on the belt, toss the scraps onto a conveyor belt above them, and then grab more meat, all in a matter of seconds. I'm now struck by how many workers there are, hundreds of them, pressed close together, constantly moving, slicing. You see hard hats, white coats, flashes of steel. Nobody is smiling or chatting. They're too busy, anxiously trying not to fall behind. An old man walks past me pushing a blue plastic barrel filled with scraps. A few workers carve the meat with wizards, small electric knives that have spinning round blades. The wizards look like the Norelco razors that Santa rides in the TV ads. I notice that a few of the women near me are sweating, even though the place is freezing cold. And it also, just the syntax here, you're completely overwhelmed. We could talk about polysyndeton, asyndeton, we talk about compound sentences, cumulative sentences here. But the point is that the effect that he's getting by using these sentences that work by accretion is that the reader is feeling overwhelmed. The reader can't help but start to feel the stultifying, pretty horrifying environment here. You can't move. People aren't speaking. Again, what characterizes human beings is speech, and they are not speaking here. They are denied that. They are completely immersed or required to be immersed in their task. Then we get into even more graphic descriptions here. Sides of beasts suspended from an overhead trolley swing toward a group of men. Each worker has a large knife in one hand and a steel hook in the other. They grab the meat with their hooks and attack it fiercely with their knives. As they hack away using all their strength, grunting, the place suddenly feels different, primordial. The machinery seems beside the point, and what's going on before me has been going on for thousands of years. The meat, the hook, the knife, men straining to cut more meat. This is my favorite paragraph in it. I think here he kind of pulls everything together, and you do have that sense of the human beings in this setting, the only thing they do is grunt. And then you also have the visuals here of the sides of beasts suspended from an overhead trolley. And so they're kind of overwhelmed by these carcasses. On the kill floor, what I see no longer unfolds in a logical manner. It's one strange image after another. And here we really do get the surrealism. A worker with a power saw slices cattle into halves as though they were 2x4s, and then the halves swing by me into the cooler. It feels like a slaughterhouse now. Dozens of cattle stripped of their skins dangle on chains from their hind legs. I did warn you about this one. This is the horror movie. My host stops and asks how I feel, if I want to go any further. This is where some people get sick. I feel fine, determined to see the whole process, the world that's been deliberately hidden. Talk about ethos here. Okay, other people get sick. I don't. I'm fine. I'm going to see it all. So you, again, have the sense of the person who's giving you this account being a person of strength, commitment, and also absolutely laser-focused purpose. The kill floor is hot and humid. It stinks of manure. Cattle have a body temperature of about 101 degrees, and there are a lot of them in the room. Carcasses swing so fast along the rail that you have to keep an eye on them constantly, dodge them, watch your step, or one will slam you and throw you onto the bloody concrete floor. It happens to workers all the time. Now, I'm actually not going to go into the next paragraph where we see a man reach inside the cattle and pull out their kidneys with his bare hands, because you get the picture here. There's a lot of details here, certainly appeals to pathos, but also the person is presenting information in such a way that there's a kind of objectivity to say, this is not atypical. This is something that's real. This happens. This is where these people work. This is the kind of environment in which the meat that will show up in the grocery store in those nice, clean-looking plastic containers, this is where it all starts. This is where it begins. So I think you definitely have the inferno here, and it really reminded me of Dante's Inferno because it's also cold when you get to the center of it, which is just exactly like Dante, and the kill floor. He's painting a picture of hell here pretty clearly.
For 1 second, though, in that last paragraph you didn't read, you know, there is one more reference that makes you think about audience because he mentions the white skulls painted by Georgia O'Keeffe. Pretty sophisticated.
Again, yeah, talking about audience here. And it's funny when you mention that, Robin, because we go from that allusion to, we go from this incredibly gritty and graphic description of blood and misery to that allusion to O'Keeffe, which, granted, as he says here, picking them almost as clean as the white skulls painted by Georgia O'Keeffe, and yet those paintings are so beautiful and clean, so streamlined. But you're right, his audience will get it. They will get it. Okay, let's look at how you might put these two together and how the one illuminates the other and talks back to the other. Nicole, I think we have another slide with some questions on. I would really start with three. I would say, do you consider fiction or fiction or nonfiction more effective when used to expose unfair practices and corruption? Granted, we don't have the whole book of The Jungle, nor do we have the whole book of Fast Food Nation, but you've got two excerpts here to at least start that discussion. There's obviously no answer to this. Well, maybe there is for those of us who prefer fiction. But this question, I think, would get kids to start thinking about the fact that these two authors, at different time periods, writing one fiction, one a novel, the other a nonfiction expose, are using so many of the same strategies. Although the narrative point of view is quite different in the two of them. Robin, do you have comments on these two?
I think one of the things I noticed in the Sinclair piece is he uses the second person sometimes. You know, you see this, you are there. His authorial viewpoint is kind of conversational. You were talking about the comparison contrast there, right? Or did I just leave?
Right, exactly. Yeah.
Oh, you'll have to edit that. I had a little brain blip. But that's what you were talking about, right?
Yeah, I think so. One thing I think about with that question is I was really struck as I was rereading this again by how strong there's a plot. I mean, this is a journey. This is the journey to hell. And he's taking the hero's journey here. He's going to come back. Now, those workers don't all get to come back, and if you look at the rest of that section, if you have CIA Lit, you'll see that he does zero in on a particular person, Jesus, and he talks about him and then he talks about injuries that people have sustained in this environment, and the one losing some fingers and then being told, well, if you can't use the left hand, use the right, another one who actually loses an arm gets a different kind of job, and so he does... move into very specific individuals and move the focus away from himself to some extent. But they both draw us in. There's a story here. And you have Schlosser as kind of the main character, the way you have the central character in The Jungle.
Excuse me for interrupting, but it's interesting how Jurgis sort of, in that passage, is kind of sitting there reporting what he's heard. You know, I've heard this from this person, I've heard this from another person. Whereas in the Schlosser, you know, our narrator is right in there, which is, he has a certain swagger to himself. You know, I'm strong, I'm not going to get sick. it's a little bit of authorial distance, I think, also, even though the narrator of the jungle is not there, but we become so involved with Jurgis and we care about him and his family, and he doesn't get to escape. He doesn't get to go back to his nice job writing for The Atlantic. So that's another interesting
thing. Yeah, no, I think that's great. And I also think you're right. There's hyperbole also in Schlosser. I mean, you can't not see that. I mean, Sinclair is writing as a novelist, and he has more control in some ways. Schlosser is determined to make us sick. He's determined for us to be horrified. And you're right. In the jungle, we need to care about Jurgis and his family. Is that longer lasting? In terms of protest, in
right.
terms of calling attention to an unfair practice or an immoral situation, or however you want to look at it, I think it's a fair question to ask kids to entertain. The obvious one, the compare and contrast the arguments they make. Well, their arguments are very, very similar, and they both have to do their research. The novelist has to know what's going on, just as has to be factually correct, just as the journalist does. Perhaps we don't hold the novelist to the same high standard of fact checking that we do the journalist, but he obviously did his homework. Sinclair knew what was going on. He was not making things up. And yet the presentation of them is slightly different, somewhat different here. So I think asking about the which one is more effective is a really interesting point, and one that, again, gets students into both of the passages. And I do think Robin's been emphasizing audience. I like that. I think asking who the audience is for these, and I'm not sure the audience is all that different, as you say, writing for The Atlantic. That, again, brings questions there about intent and purpose. And I think you've got two very fine writers here writing on a subject that continues. I have question four here I just want to mention before we have to sign off, and that is, are the books from which these excerpts taken still relevant? After doing some research, do you agree or disagree with Schloss's comment that Sinclair would be amazed by how little has fundamentally changed? And in CIA Lit on page, it's 969, on the 10th anniversary of the publication of Fast Food Nation, Schloss published an article in the Daily Beast lamenting that the book is still relevant. And as he talked about its relevance 10 years later, he also brought up Sinclair. So there's a nice description, a nice passage there from Schlosser, which draws the lines between the two a little more boldly and a little more clearly, so that it becomes even more of a talk back there. Robin, you want to talk a little bit about what we're going to ask them to do next?
Yes, our plan is for you to follow up. Well, first of all, we'd like you to try any one of these pairings with your classes and come back and with questions and comments on the 29th. Let us know how things worked. And you may want to use the longer passages that the Schlosser and Sinclair come from, although I think these two would work very nicely. But we're going to provide you with a couple of other texts. One is the speech that Harry Truman gave when the atomic bomb was dropped on Hiroshima. And the other is an excerpt from Jonathan Schell about the effects of atomic warfare. They're very challenging perspectives, both of them, and the Shell is quite challenging reading. The Truman, not so much, but it's really interesting rhetorically, and also for us to remember what kind of president he was. I mean, he's really good at taking responsibility on himself. So we would like you to try those two passages and come up with the questions that that you would like to ask. And Nicole, maybe you can just, I think we've got one more slide there that kind of shows what we're asking. Keep going. There we go. And come up with some of your own questions for those two texts, maybe just one or two, and then let us know when you come back on the 29th how it went. And I think, Nicole, you'll provide listeners with their, or participants with those two texts from CIA Lit?
Nicole, before we sign off, I just want to thank everybody for coming in and listening to this. We hope we've given a bit of a sequence here to start with the visual and a poem, something that's pretty accessible, moving into two more dense texts, but shorter excerpts. And then we're asking you now to look at some longer pieces. But again, there may be others in CIA Lit that you want to try out that we'd like to hear your response to that. And even more, we'd like to hear your response to ones that you're using that are
right,
not in there. And that,
right, right,
and that
right, right.
And that we haven't thought about.
Yep. Yeah. Thank you all very much for listening, and we hope you find our material useful, and we really would like some feedback on it. Thanks again.
I look forward to seeing you on the 29th or hearing from you before then. Thank you so much. Bye now.
Hello, everyone. This is Nicole Desiato from Bedford Freeman & Worth Publishing Group. Thank you for listening to this recording. Don't forget to register for our interactive question and answer session with Renee and Robin on October 29th at 4 p.m. Eastern. You can email me questions in advance. We're looking forward to working with you then. Thank you.